I was a bit apprehensive before starting FOC tuning, as it proved to be tricky for many. However, it was absolutely necessary for me to try it, as Toyota Prius gearbox has synchronous permanent magnet motor, which absolutely does require field-oriented control, a short FOC tuning. FOC control, who cares? Why do we need it? I have motor spinning in the sine mode. There is very fine line between positive and negative torque. Because of this, field-oriented control is absolutely necessary for synchronous motors. Not many people know that Tesla Model S is actually uses AC induction motors, where Tesla Model 3, they started using magnets and they use synchronous switch reluctance permanent magnet motor. The reason why is because it gives much more efficiency. So at the same time, what's interesting is that Toyota actually been using this in their Prius gearbox for quite a while, and we hopefully will use it in our electric car conversion. Hello, I'm Ed and I'm building an electric car conversion. I've spent a few weeks working on the Toyota Prius inverter and the open inverter board. In the previous episodes, I cracked open Prius Gen 3 inverter, I ordered open inverter board, soldered some connectors and even cut a few corners. The challenge I set myself is to build an electric car conversion on the budget. Therefore, I was choosing components for my project very carefully. So far, I managed to purchase an inverter at very good price. And now I acquired Toyota Prius gearbox, aka my electric motor, at an equally good price. I've got the motor spinning now in the sine mode. All I have left is to crack the puzzle of the FOC tuning, and my motor will be ready for use. First, I need to start connecting resolver wires. So I split them in three pairs. So effectively, this our exciter, and those two would be our sine and cosine, which of course we don't know which one's which. But, you know, let's give it a try. Okay, I connected the resolver. So I tried to use a method recommended by Damien in this FOC tuning video, although I wasn't sure I was getting the right connection there. And I went on the internet and I found the drawing of the connector for the resolver for MG1. So yeah, basically according to this diagram, the connection, obviously those two black and yellow are the temperature sensor. And then the white wire on this side closest to me would be the cosine, and the gray wire, which looks pretty much like white, it's a sine. And then the purple wire, it's exciter. And the opposite side, the brown one is the exciter, and the red is cosine return, and orange is a sine. Right, so now I'm going to rotate the motor. And we're gonna see what's happening with the signal. Okay, so we are getting good reading now. And you can see that the encoder is reading from 0 to 360 degrees. So yeah, if I'm going to the opposite direction, I'm getting decent reading for the resolver for 0 to 360 angle there. To start testing current sensors, I will need to program some initial parameters into the inverter. I will start from pole pairs and resolver pole pairs. So we use 4 and 2 for these parameters. Then I will select resolver mode and followed by frequency 4.4 kHz and enter EL1 gain and EL2 gain as 3.09 degrees per ampere. Next important parameter is pin swap. I need to set pin swap to PWM output to 3. Let me explain what pin swap means and why do I need to set this value. Basically what it is, most of the inverter manufacturers, they sense PWM1 and PWM2 with the current sensor, so PWM3 is not sensed at all. However, Toyota, they something different. So Toyota sends PWM2 and PWM3, and PWM1 is not sensed at all. So what pin swap does is actually swaps the current sensors, so they will monitor PWM signals in a Toyota way. To finish off, I need to set UDC minimum to 0, as my voltage is only 60, and change the temperature maximum to 150. Our last thing I need to do is just to save the parameters to flash. I removed my pliers so that this one will not sort of jam into anything, and just entered a manual ID 1 amp. So I can hear a bit of a whine, but that's about it. Now I entered manual ID 3 amps, and I can see that my bulb is now illuminating. Now I'm gonna try manual ID 0. Okay, now I decided to try turn off the switch. I actually don't have a battery, and my supply may not be supplying the full current, and also I have quite a low voltage, it's only 60 volts. So let's see what happens with the motor in this mode. So now I'm setting current to 3 amps, nothing, 4 amps, and we have rotation, 5 amps. Let's try, a bit more, 6 amps. It's rotating nicely. And now I've got back to 0 amps and it's stopped. Now, just a quick few words about strategy for Syncofs tuning. So effectively what we will do, we will start from very low coefficient, close to 0, and we'll start increasing it. And what we will find that to make motor move, we'll have to increase the current. Higher the Syncof value is, the higher current is required to move the motor. And at some point, increasing current further will not move the motor. So this is really the point where we're looking for. So this is the perfect alignment of magnetic fields that we require. So, but then if we increase the Syncofs further, we will get that basically motor will start moving with a lower current, but in opposite direction. I've just started inverter in manual mode. I'm starting from sync offset 0. So the idea is we're going to increase manual ID values. See how our motor reacts. So manual ID 4, there's no movement. Manual ID 6, and now we have movement. Okay, going back to 0. So the idea is we're going to increase a sync offset number. Sync offset now is 0. So we're gonna go to 1000. And once we increase sync offset, we're going to see that we need more and more current for manual ID to be able to turn our motor. Manual ID 6, same, manual ID 7. Manual ID 8, and now it's beginning to turn. So now we have to go up to manual ID 8 to be able to get our motor turning. Okay, so back to 0, and now I'm gonna go to 8. Still have motion, back to 0, spot values, and now we're going back to manual ID 10, there is no motion, At 15 we have motion, so we are getting close to our expected value. So let's go to 0, 8000. Spot values. So basically we are narrowing down our range. So we'll start again from 20. 22. Interesting, I now can hear some vibration. 25, 30. So let's go to 0. So now the test is if we go and overshoot our sync offset value, whenever that is. So if we go to 10,000. Now it's rotating in the opposite direction, I think. let's just double check. Let's go to zero. So now it looks like we have... I've typed in 1,000. That's silly me. It's supposed to be 10,000. So let's try 30 again. There is no rotation. So try 30 again. There is no rotation. Going back to zero. And try 12,000. And now we're going the opposite direction. So that means we did overshoot. We did overshoot our value. So let's try 4. So let's try 5. Let's try 6. It does rotate very slowly. 7. It is faster. So we are getting close to our expected values. So I think we're very close to range of around about 10,000. So if I go 10,000 again, 30 amps. Yeah, I think it's clearly going into this vibration mode. So let me try, come back, change it to 9,800. I don't think my power supply can give 40. Yeah, you can see now it's vibrating more and more. So I think we're very close. I'm gonna keep it 9,800. Let's try 9,900. Go to spot values and try 40 again. Pretty much the same. Okay, now we're gonna try a different test. We're gonna try 0.1. Oops. 0.1 manual IQ. And it goes. Okay, now if we put manual IQ 0. And if we tuned it correctly, if we go -3, it should go in opposite direction, but it doesn't. Okay, it goes with 3, but quite strange.